Thank you. Welcome everyone to our second TALF discussion. We're here to discuss the new term sheet issued by the Fed on April 9th. I'm Matt Hayes. I'm a partner in Dechert Chicago office. I lead the ABS team and I'm focused on the TALF program. Tim?
Thanks, Matt. And thanks everyone for attending on and being part of this conversation with us about TALF. My name is Timothy Spangler. I'm a private funds partner. I've been setting up a variety of fund vehicles for the last 2.5 decades. I have very, very fond memories, very clear, vivid memories of TALF 1.0, as Matt does as well. And I think we're seeing a lot of that enthusiasm expand out among fund managers and fund investors about what the potential for TALF 2.0 brings. So this is the second webinar we've given on this topic in the last couple of weeks. We won't be going back over introductory material. We'll assume a pretty high prior understanding of TALF. And what we'll be trying to do now is really talk about the revised term sheet that was circulated last week, give you thoughts on what we're seeing in terms of approaching the opportunity, and try to give you some of the insights that we've been building up. We've been working on many, many of these projects over the last couple of weeks, and we're seeing, as I said earlier, a tremendous amount of enthusiasm from a variety of fund managers out there who are interested in this area. So I'll kick off first, and I want to talk a little bit about the updated term sheet. And it's important to realize the term sheet's all we have so far. The term sheet originally issued at the end of March, updated last week. Federal Reserve has made a number of clarifications and additions. While a number of the clarifications have been incredibly helpful, there have been some ambiguities created in transporting some of the legislative language from the CARES Act into the term sheet that people are scratching their heads and saying, as written, this is not going to make the TALF program 2.0, much like TALF 1.0, and in essence, making it kind of a dead on arrival, so to speak. So we'll be going through a number of the opportunities and also a number of the challenges that need to be addressed in the coming weeks. The TALF program is both expanded and contracted based on the changes that came out last week. The good news, which had been lobbied for and advocated for since TALF 2.0 was announced, was that the range of ABS that can be financed under the TALF program was increased significantly. Matt will go through all of that in detail. Somewhat surprisingly, a limit was imposed. It limited the types of eligible borrowers by imposing a requirement that on its face, which we'll go into detail in a moment, only a U.S. company with employees in the United States and operations in the United States could borrow. Now, this is language that's contained in the CARES Act and is meant to apply to a whole range of programs established under the CARES Act. How that concept of a U.S.-based company applies either in the world of investment funds or in the world of ABS issues is what's causing these questions. The definition of U.S. companies, just reading it from the CARES Act and from the revised Fed term sheet, is now defined as businesses that are created or organized in the U.S. or under the laws of the United States and that have significant operations in and a majority of their employees based in the United States. Now, if people recall from 2009, there was a U.S., a significant U.S. requirement baked in to TALF 1.0. The borrower had to be a U.S. entity, and if it was an investment vehicle, the advisor to that vehicle had to be a U.S.-based investment advisor. So the same concept existed 12 years ago. This construction of it, though, raises significant questions about, well, how would an investment fund, any type of investment fund, qualify for that? But even more significantly, which Matt will go into in some detail in a moment, it makes the traditional ABS issuer vehicles not in the definition as well. And I think that's what's causing a lot of the trade associations now to go back and lobby with the Federal Reserve in order to get this sort of clarification. I'll hand it over to Matt to go through the detail now, but one thing I want to kind of report from the front line, the market, those people who were excited about TALF 3.5 weeks ago and are building their TALF funds and speaking to their investors and kind of working towards participating in this in a significant way, that work is continuing. The view from the industry, the view from the trade associations, the view from our clients that we continue to get is, well, this just has to be resolved. It just has to, or else there will be no TALF at all. This isn't just a question of will TALF 2.0 be worse than TALF 1.0. With this definition kind of crudely applied, then it makes the program a non-starter. So I think there's a broad optimism that some level of application will be made. In investment funds, perhaps the best view would be to apply it to the fund management business rather than the fund itself, maybe to have some sort of restriction on the number of non-US LPs you have in a fund. There are various theories that are being advocated for. But to go into the detail on this, I want to turn it over now to Matt.
Thanks, Tim. That's right that the eligible borrower and issuer of ABS to constitute eligible collateral under the program must be U.S. businesses, and that definition comes from the CARES Act. I think that the broader question, just to dig a little deeper on that, is that in 2009, the primary dealer was deputized by the Fed to implement the diligence procedures that were required under the program of whether borrowers met that standard. So I think the question now is, without more guidance, can a primary dealer implementing that rule, sort of look through? I think we'd really like guidance on that to understand what the process will look like, and also so that managers, borrowers, dealers, and issuers know what they need to do. I think the hope is that on the issuer side, that could apply to the sponsor of the ABS transaction, which is generally an operating company, which you could apply that standard to. I think for the SPVs, there's really no way to do that without some kind of look through, because all the issuers are SPVs. We're working with a number of the trade associations on these concerns and explaining them to the Fed and Treasury, so that hopefully we can get some better guidance on the language that was added in the last term sheet. It's also notable that the language before specifically included foreign investors that could be invested into the U.S. Vehicle. I think that's another open question of whether there's the standard applies to that. I think from a supporting businesses and providing liquidity perspective, it would be challenging to have any standard that applies to on that basis. So we'll see where that ends up. But that's part of the current effort. With respect to the eligible collateral, I think that there was some positive developments in that legacy commercial mortgage-backed securities, so those issued prior to March 23rd, 2020, were included as eligible collateral, as well as static pool CLO transactions backed by leveraged loans issued on or after March 23rd. It further clarified that the static pool meant that it was not subject to any substitution. I'll get into a little bit of some of the issues related to that in a minute. But I think that there's still a lobbying effort that we understand for other asset classes too. You know, I think ones that weren't included include aircraft, rail car, personal unsecured, residential mortgages. There's no action taken on any of those, even though there's some lobbying efforts ongoing related to those asset classes. But I think we'll see whether the Fed takes any action on that. In addition to the inclusion of legacy commercial mortgage-backed securities, the Fed expressly excluded commercial real estate CLOs and single asset, single borrower CMBS. It's not clear whether that guidance was intended to indicate that the Fed's not going to include those asset classes, or whether it just wasn't in the existing structure to be clear that they weren't yet done with that process. I don't think we have much insight into that yet, but we're working on getting it. The Fed also didn't clarify whether the mortgage-backed CMBS could include single-family rental mortgage loans and whether that could qualify as a CMBS for purposes of TALF. So I think we'll look to see what the definition that finally defines what that means is, and whether that's consistent with the legacy CMBS that was included in 2009, which was also a later addition to the TALF program then. There's a couple other asset classes that were included in the latest version of the term sheet. Equipment leases, formerly only equipment loans, were included. With respect to the commercial mortgages, it had to be on a real property located in the United States or one of its territories. One notable change, though, is the removal of eligible servicing advances from the list of underlying credit exposures that can back eligible ABS collateral. I think that's certainly a concern to the non-bank's mortgage servicing market because of the number of servicing advances that are required in the current environment or potentially required in the current environment. I think that we're waiting for some guidance on the reason for that. Our initial sense is that there are other programs that are being set up to address residential mortgages and servicing advances from some other regulators. So I think that there may be a view that including that in the ABS definition for collateral might crowd out other asset classes, even though there's some program availability for those asset classes, but that's not entirely clear right now. I think we're hopeful that we'll get a little more clarity on what exactly can be included so that both issuers and investors can sort of understand the types of transactions and better understand the collateral that can be originated and included, since it's likely that collateral originated right now will be eligible for the program based on how the recently issued definitions work. On the pricing point, the Fed basically completely changed the pricing methodology. It was formerly based on a LIBOR plus a spread standard, two or three. So that was also changed in this version for CLOs. It has a 30-day average SOFR, which is the new base rate that the Federal Reserve Bank of New York is publishing, plus 150. It's 30-day average. I think our expectation is that's a simple average of 30-day in arrears SOFR. The other non-CLO assets that are not SBA guaranteed is the overnight index swap rate plus 125, and then SBA pool certificates are different than the SBA Development Company participation certificates. One's OIS, the other one's federal fund. One thing this does create, though, because most assets are currently still priced on a LIBOR basis, is a basis mismatch between the loan that the Fed will provide and the underlying collateral. That creates certainly a problem for floating rate liabilities because, as you'll see in a second, the spread differential between, for example, LIBOR and SOFR has been all over the map in the past, month or so. I think it's currently not clear how that basis mismatch will be accounted for. Last time there wasn't a mark-to-market concept in the documents. I think it obviously affects the yield to the equity if you have it, there was nothing to sort of reprice the loan or create a margin call concept. And also, there's really no guidance on whether hedging would be permitted. It may be something to think about, though, if you're investing in that. I also put a poll from the Federal Reserve Bank of St. Louis. This chart basically took three-month LIBOR, subtracted a 30-day average SOFR in arrears, and you can see the spread differential. It's over 100 basis point swing in a two-month period So, you know, I think it's a question of whether it will stabilize, but even before the crisis, as you can see from the chart, going back to when data became available from the Federal Reserve Bank of New York on SOFR, it generally, you know, it's a slightly tighter range that's really expanded significantly, but it's still a pretty big range. So if you're planning to, you know, sort of have a decent return on this investment, I think it has a significant effect, you know, on which direction you think that spread differential is going to go between your assets and liabilities. The haircuts were also released in the latest version of the term sheet by the Fed. This is the amount the eligible borrower is required to fund in connection with a purchase, assuming you're settling at the same time, or the equity portion, effectively, that the borrower has to put up. It's substantially consistent with the haircut schedule from 2008, and it's also still determined by asset class and weighted average life of the asset. And all asset classes must have a weighted average life of 5 years or less, other than underlying credit exposures that are legacy CMBS, static CLOs, student loans, and SBA loans. These asset classes may have a weighted life over 5 years, but not more than 10. And then, as you see in the chart, they go up by 1% for each year beyond the window. So here's the schedule. And as you can see, auto is still pretty granular in terms of, you know, subgroups within the asset class. So I think, you know, one thing if you're looking at auto is, you know, does an issuer sort of do two different deals if they have any kind of commingled pool, you know, or if they fit into one category clearly. You know, each of these asset classes had an origination date last time around that the underlying collateral needed to be originated after. I think it'll be, you know, interesting to see what that date is and if there's a far enough look back to, you know, historical assets of or whether they can be included in the as eligible collateral in the program. Tim?
Absolutely. So interesting changes last week. The core of the program stays the same, though. The size of the TALF program is currently pegged at $100 billion. As with so much of TALF 1.1, there is the possibility that TALF 2.0 may evolve, may change, may shift during the course of its operation. We saw that 12 years ago. It is definitely a possibility now. The magic date, except for legacy CMBS, continues to be March 23rd, 2020, and that's a reference date for so many of the analyses that Matt has identified. As before and as in 2009, the Department of the Treasury is a key component of this, and they'll be investing $10 billion into the special purpose vehicle that is at the heart of the lending transaction backed by the Federal Reserve. What also has remained the same post the second draft of the term sheet arriving last week is the general commercial assumption that, together with the U.S. business definition being resolved in a amicable and profitable way, that the rails for TALF 2.0 will be largely the same as TALF 1.0. As we're looking at product, as we're drafting term sheets, as we're having conversations with LPs about fund structures and the like, the reason so much ground has been covered in those on the back of a 2.5-page term sheet in the last month has been this continued assumption across the market that at the end of the day, TALF 2.0 will operate in a very similar manner to TALF 1.0. There are important differences, and I want to hand it over to Matt to talk about one of the most important differences, which is the inclusion of CLOs.
Thanks, Tim. The CLO addition is obviously welcome, I think, for both the CLO industry and the leveraged loan market. Some of the concerns, though, you know, related to the terms of adding CLO securities, I think it makes it somewhat challenging for market participants to issue CLOs, you know, and relatedly for the borrowers to buy CLOs. The underlying credit exposures must be newly issued as defined in the new term sheet, which isn't really defined. It's a standard that before the last version of TALF in 2009, as I alluded to before, had a issuance date that could be back a couple years. You know, if newly issued means the leveraged loan had to have been created after March 23rd, 2020, that obviously creates the issue of originators of the underlying leveraged loans having to you know, go out and basically create those assets. The other related issue is there's, you know, a decent number of leveraged loans that are still on warehouse facilities and on balance sheets that you know, would ordinarily be securitized if the market were healthy. You know, I think the big question is whether those can be included in the newly issued definition or not, and what the look-back period is. I think if it's after March 23rd, you know, to get to a fully ramped static pool CLO would be quite a challenging, you know, effort to do, because it's just not enough time in the typical issuance cycle to pool enough leveraged loans to do a CLO. So that's certainly a concern that we're looking at right now and working with the Fed to understand better. You know, I think that the second is sort of a planning question of, you know, if you're looking to, you know, set up a new warehouse, what are the warehouse terms, you know, right now that you get, you know, how much time does it take to get the warehouse set up if you don't have one? You know, ramping the portfolio is certainly a challenge to then close by September 30th, you know, assuming the deadline isn't extended, which I think is still somewhat of an open question. It probably depends mostly on how long the economic turmoil lasts and what performance looks like. So we're currently monitoring that. The third general area is that the sort of the standard around what static CLO means, I think, is a bit of a question that you know, needs a little bit more clarification. You know, I think our hope is that substitution may just mean the ability to, you know, voluntarily swap out collateral. I think it's a little bit more concerning if it's credit risk loans or sales of defaulted loans and realizing the proceeds from those transactions, because some of the underlying leveraged loans may need to be restructured. You know, how does that look? How does it work? I think there's some clarity that we'll need around that for the market to really be able to take advantage of this new standard in a clear way. You know, there's also, I think, the question around substantial operations in the U.S. businesses standard applies quite a bit to this as well. I think, you know, hopefully we can get a standard that requires to be a company organized in the United States as the issuer, you know, applying the same sponsor standard. You know, I think that the predecessor TALF program, as Tim alluded to earlier, has a good standard for at least on the borrower side for the investment manager. Whether that could also be the CLO sponsor, you know, I think would be a welcome development too, since that you know, would likely be some kind of an operating fund manager that also would have employees. So that would be a welcome addition if we get it, and would make the CLO market much more functional. Tim?
Now I can go back and talk about TALF funds with a minute less than I had before. We are working towards the eligible borrower being modified, that definition being modified, either back to the March 23rd term sheet or going back to a focus, as in TALF 1.0, focusing on the fund manager as the entity that needs the U.S. Presence and the U.S. substance. The market continues to assume large parts of it, at least the ones that are active with us, assuming that such changes are going to be made, and therefore have been spending the last few weeks very productively, investment management firms, looking at a variety of products. We are taking into account scenarios where the definition of eligible borrower is not as robust as we would hope in 2009, that approach there. We know what the goal of TALF 2.0 is. It's the same as the goal of TALF 1.0, which is to bring capital into the securitization markets to continue that ability of that part of the market to function. What we also remember from TALF 1.0 is the very, very strong returns it provided to investors and the very successful product that those TALF funds were for the investment management firms and sponsors who were able to bring those to the market and bring them to the market early. A theme of our first webinar and a theme of much of our work with our clients now who are launching TALF funds is to go in early. Make sure that you're there, make sure that you're available. The best returns, the best trades are going to be found in those first few months of the TALF period. So continuing to assume that the structure that largely worked in 2009 and 10 will work here. We've been very busy and hope to be continue to be very busy in the coming weeks. We still only have a term sheet. And I think when we're looking at the open issues, when we're looking at the challenges, understand that we are still only at a two and a half page term sheet. We are looking forward to the full procedures and documentation coming from the Federal Reserve quite soon. We know that there is some very productive lobbying and consultation going on with the Fed. Based on that, we continue to be, and our clients continue to be optimistic that the Federal Reserve and the Treasury will be able to make the changes and add the interpretive guidance and the details to allow not only TALF to be successful, but for these TALF funds to be successful as well. Not only Matt and I, but a good number of the lawyers here at Dechert will continue to be following these changes quite closely in the coming weeks, and we anticipate that there's going to be a lot of good activity in the coming months around a successful TALF 2.0 program. I'll just say thank you all for taking the time. If you have any questions about the material, please feel free to contact either Matt or I, contact your regular relationship person within the firm, and I'll turn it over to Matt.
Hey, thanks, everybody. As Tim said, we're closely monitoring the developments in both from the trade association perspective and with the Fed. We'll, to the extent anyone has any questions, we're happy to talk through those, and we'll try to set something up at your convenience. Appreciate the time. Thanks, everybody.